a country, the word tuberculosis has not been in their lexicon for 50 years. They don't actually realize how big the problem is outside the U.S. But infectious diseases, they're starting to get a picture of that. And now I can at least tell them that 40% of all the deaths in the countries where we would sell products, if we were to be a successful company, are due to infectious diseases. Interestingly, we're now seeing that many of the autoimmune diseases have an infectious origin. And I think that's going to help us all in understanding more about how microbes interact with our bodies, both in a beneficial way and in a difficult way for our immune systems to understand. And I think more than anything that's scaring the public health communities around the world is the fact that multi-drug resistant organisms are coming to the fore. And we don't have enough antibiotics, and we've really paid no attention to antibiotics for a number of years. The new classes of antibiotics are few and far between. They're fairly specific for the gram-positive, mainly gram-positive organisms these days, and we're actually experiencing a crisis, both in this country and in Europe. And multi-drug-resistant infections, and in particular, multi-drug-resistant TB, is now considered a national security threat, both in the United States and in Europe. So TB is a problem on every continent. We're not without our TB. You can see by the color of the country how many cases per 100,000 exist. Clearly, in areas that have the darkest numbers, we have the most number of TB patients, but we have them in the United States as well. And I don't know how many of you remember the SARS epidemic. That's where we were completely panicked about SARS. This came out in the New York Times in 2003, basically talking about SARS is a problem, yes, but at SARS, in terms of numbers of people affected by SARS, number of people who died of SARS, there were at that time around 500 people who had died of SARS. At the same time, 2 million people died of TB. So the scale of our panic over certain of infections across our borders is unfortunate, let's put it that way. And tuberculosis, which we have a wonderful TB elimination program in the United States, has moved TB down out of our line of sight. But outside the world, it's burgeoning everywhere. And part of the reason that it's so successful is that it's an airborne transmitted disease. And you may not know this, but the no-spitting laws in New York City aren't about the fact that spitting is gross. It's about transmission of TB. So to be able to be transmitted by the air easily, you have to have a certain particle size. And that's where SARS is. And that's where TB is. So it is the perfect size to be passed person to person by sitting next to someone who is infected. And in the United States, whether we are comfortable knowing this or not, we have drug and multi-drug-resistant TB. There were over 1,000 cases of drug-resistant TB in the U.S. last year, 10,000, that's 10%. And we have 6 cases of virtually untreatable, extremely drug-resistant TB, for which we have no drugs. And right now, in the world, we have poor drugs. With the drugs that we have, there are 8 to 9 million new cases of drug-sensitive TB every year. It takes 6 months of treatment with 4 drugs, each of which have their own toxicities, some blindness, some liver toxicities, and there's about an 80% treatment success rate globally. For multi-drug-resistant TB, there's now about 500 to 650,000 cases estimated by the World Health Organization. The definition is that they're resistant to the first 2 best TB drugs out there, isoniazid and rifampin. You then have to choose from 6 of the just horrendously bad drugs. One is cycloserine, which the patients call cycloserine, gives them psychotic episodes. There's kanamycin, which causes irreversible loss of hearing. Another drug, irreversible loss of sight. And you have to take these drugs for up to 24 months in order to cure this disease. There's only about a 48% cure rate. An extremely deadly disease in TB, which is now here in the United States and is now detected in every country in the world, you need much more than 24 months to treat these patients, and there are no drugs. They are trying everything in the armamentarium that we have to find drugs, and Chris has been a leader in finding drugs that can rescue these people from certain death. How do you feel? I feel kind of anxious now. So the biggest problem that we have in TB is that this is a pathogen that can live inside cells and can live outside cells. So we have to have drugs that not only can get to the interstitial fluids in our tissues to kill those cells that are outside, but we need drugs that can penetrate the macrophage where it lives and replicates and kill the bug there. So it's pretty tricky to get a drug that can go through a macrophage membrane, that can wander through the macrophage cytoplasm, can get into the cytolysosome where the TB organism is, and to survive there long enough to get inside the TB organism and then kill it. So finding drugs for TB is just a challenge. Because we have another issue with TB, this has confounded the problem of finding drugs, and that is that TB used to be the number one killer of U.S. citizens prior to 1950. And those of you who are as old as I am all have a relative who died of TB. This organism was the impetus for pharmaceutical companies to get into the business of drug discovery and development. And many of the first drugs that came out were specifically directed to TB. every time we introduced a drug, within 6 months the organism became resistant to that drug. So now we know that we have at least a minimum of 3 drugs that we have to treat people with to avoid resistance that occurs, to penetrate those appropriate tissues harboring the bacteria, and to kill both replicating bacteria and the trick that mycobacteria does, it goes dormant. It lies there unassumingly waiting for its chance to start replicating again, and we don't even know where it is. So the goals of new TB drug development include identification of drugs with novel mechanisms of action. We need to pair three novel drugs together to increase both tissue distribution and kill various bacterial forms. We need to reduce the regimen toxicity, which is a problem in drug-sensitive TB, but which is a horrific problem in MDR and XDR TB. And hopefully at some point we will be able to shorten the treatment time. Now this isn't a regulatory goal, and it's not the basis for approval of any drug, but it's certainly a public health compliance goal. So we're going to go in, Cliff is going to take over here, but I've never actually told Cliff why we started working together. I mean, he probably has his own stories as well. But I thought I would just reveal to you what happened to put Cliff and Carol together 15 years ago. So at that time, Tom Kent was the head of intramural research here at the NIH, and to start my academic career, he was a friend and a colleague. I had a problem, and he had a problem, and we agreed to try to help each other. My problem was nearly trivial. My problem was that I had started sequela, and someone wanted to make a documentary film, a subject of which has long left my mind, and I needed an office that looked like an office. I was running the company out of my home, and I needed a bookcase filled not with children's books, but with medical texts. And he offered, we used his bookcase, which was very beautiful, as a background for that. His problem was more concerning. He had a very, very bright young scientist who was working in Hamilton, Montana, and who he had to bring back here to the NIH campus. And this scientist wasn't exactly happy to be coming back here. He had a very nice wife in Hamilton, Montana. Well, I don't know how long that, but nonetheless. And so Tom asked if I would introduce myself to Cliff and see if I could generate a project when he got here that would keep him interested enough. Tom was very concerned that Cliff would get here and then would leave the NIH, and he thought the government needed Cliff. So I went to a Gordon conference on TV, and I introduced myself to Cliff, and we talked, and this whole process worked because he's still here. So anyway, so that's the story of why we are together. Now I'm going to let Cliff tell you a little bit about his lab.
So, I wasn't doing the script, Carol.
I know.
So I'm going to take just a second to briefly introduce each of our respective organizations and where this project is in, and then we're going to wind the clock back 15 years and literally walk you through the project that happened. And mostly, I think there's nobody in my laboratory, and there's a few of you out there now who was actually present in the laboratory when this project started, or even when they stopped working on it for a long period of time. So what my group does these days, and we've done different iterations of this and have different emphasis over time, is we try to build a pipeline. There's always talk at NIH about bench to bedside stuff, right? Well, I'm a chemist, so I don't do benches, we do hoods, right? So we talk about hoods to bedside stuff. So we try to recreate the entire process of doing drug discovery to the point that we can do it at NIH within the intramural research program. So a lot of the lab will work on things like high-throughput screening, systems biology, whole cell screening, trying to understand what are vulnerable points in metabolism and how do we deal with this organism. And then we'll move into animal model studies. That happens to be a very cute little monkey there, so we do some things in monkeys, some things in mice, and using tools that we can apply in the clinic, like imaging analysis, PET CT scans, things, biomarkers, and we try to pilot clinical trial design. And then we actually do clinical trials, starting pretty much with phase two, where we try to take those things we learn from the animal studies and translate them directly into people. And I'm not going to talk about anything in the last two phases, because I just want to point out that a lot of my group is engaged in that sort of activity these days. But back in 1998 or so, we really focused much more on the early part of the pipeline, because we didn't have very much to go later in the pipeline at that point. And I wanted to show you this, because I think it's important for two reasons. Because this is my current group, and I love to make people in the group angry by pointing out that they're arranged in order of importance by discipline. So the chemists are all in the front, the biologists, and then the sort of animal model people languish in the back. And then all of the clinical work that we do is offshore, mostly in South Korea and China. And this is a part of my clinical team and other visitors, that's not that big, that actually put these things into humans and get information that feeds back all the way back to the beginning of the pipeline. So we develop better and better tools and better approaches for introducing new chemotherapy into the clinic. And I also just wanted to acknowledge up front the people who really did this work. And the principal driver of a lot of this particular project was a postdoctoral fellow who joined me after finishing up at Oxford, Richard Lee, who was a very talented chemist and now runs his own very successful group that still works in TB drug discovery at St. Jude's down in Tennessee. And many other people made contributions. I'm absolutely sure I left people off of this slide because literally this was 15 years ago that a lot of this was really starting and that people were jumping in and out of it. And I also included the people in tech transfer that made fundamental contributions to setting this up right at the beginning so that at the end we had a product to show for it and we didn't get lost along the way. And I'm equally certain that I've left people off that list, but those are the ones that I can remember that dealt with us on a day-to-day basis in establishing this project up front.
So I'd like to just introduce you to Sequela. Leo Lange and I founded Sequela with two other founders, by the way, in 1997 as a way to as a for-profit biotechnology company on a global health issue, which is tuberculosis. We've gotten a lot different in the last 15 years for a variety of different reasons, and now we have actually compounds that work on all of these different infections. We do drug discovery in-house. We played off of Cliff taught us how to do combinatorial chemistry and high-throughput screening, and we brought it in-house. And so now we have a compound library of about 250,000 molecules of various different classes. And I have two fabulous Russian women chemists who are just beyond belief good at what they do. So we're currently focused specifically on three infections: mycobacterium tuberculosis, one third of the world infected. Lots of people get it annually. And WHO reports lots of multi-drug resistant TB. Staphylococcus pylori infections have even better statistics, 1 in 2. It's really awesome, isn't it? Causes gastritis and gastric cancer. There are too many cases, too many deaths every year, and there's a lot of antibiotic resistance. And we'll